Right. Good morning. Good morning. Good to be here together. We're halfway through. Halfway through the summer. Ah! Someone the other day said, only 3 weeks left till they go back to school. And I was like, yay? No, not yay. I love being with my kids. And we're halfway through our summer series. Ordinary people, uncommon faith. In fact, let's say that together. Ordinary people, uncommon faith. Raise your hand if you're one of those ordinary people. I'll raise two. Very ordinary. But God says, and we're going to learn it again today, that he works through the ordinary who have uncommon faith. And each week, as we've been coming, and again today, the word of God is going to revive in our hearts faith. That's uncommon. So far, we've learned, remember way back in Hebrews 11, we learned about the impact of persevering faith. And then the friends of the paralytic taught us about relentless faith. And the bleeding woman showed us how to have reckless faith. Through Barnabas, he modeled how faith moves us to reconcile. And then last week, Pastor Dave taught us through the model of the thief on the cross about redeeming faith. So go ahead and grab your Bibles and turn, would you, to the Old Testament. We're going to Joshua chapter 2. Because this morning, a Canaanite woman named Rahab is going to teach us that faith risks it all to have it all. Rahab is going to teach us that faith risks it all to have it all. Now, I understand that when I say the word risk, it may generate some kind of reaction in you. For some, you're like, bring it. I live, eat, and breathe adventure. You need a steady stream of high-risk activity, otherwise life is lame. Whereas others of you are risk-averse, and you're just fine having both feet on the ground at all times. And so I want to be really clear about what this message is going for. What we're going for is not motivating thrill seekers to jump off higher ledges or pressuring the safety conscious to sign up for the next skydiving class. It's not what we're doing. What we are going to do is let God's word examine our faith so that you would be more willing to take the risks that God would call you to take, faith-driven risks that would allow you to fulfill the purpose that God has for you. Now, when it comes to risk, I feel like I've done life with risk for most of my years, whether it's way back in elementary school when I was pushing the limits on the jungle gym, or as a 15-year-old traveling to the Soviet Union to play soccer. What was my mom thinking letting me do that? My mom's here, I'm just picking on her a little bit. Or spent 10 years as a support-based missionary. In other words, I've spent a lot of time in those places of, if God doesn't show up, if this doesn't work out, it's not gonna go well. And so, a few weeks ago when we were on our family trip down to North Carolina, and my son Jordan said that he wanted me to take him to the amusement park there in Charlotte to ride Fury 325, the newest, fastest, tallest roller coaster. I was terrified. And so, in case you're wondering, do the numbers mean anything in that name? Yes, they do. Fury 325, that stands for the number of feet that you go up and then straight down at 100 death-defying miles per hour. And so I thought, okay, I'm gonna do whatever I can to reason Jordan out of this. Like, bro, it's Charlotte in July. It's gonna be so hot, and it's gonna be so crowded. But I know my son, and I know that those excuses would have been lame. And so, with a herd of butterflies tying my stomach in knots, the epic moment came, and here's how it went.
Thank you, and enjoy Fury 325.
you know what? We went on it twice. It was awesome. I learned two lessons that day. Number one, screaming really loud helps a lot. I also learned that roller coaster just that day took hundreds of people on the ride of their lives. In other words, the risk started to not feel quite so risky as I got to see that this ride was faithful and reliable, which meant now that I had a choice to make. Was I going to play it safe and miss out on an awesome moment, or was I going to take the risk? And on that day, I could push myself to take that risk because I saw what I needed to see right before me. But what are you going to do on that day when God calls you to step out and take a risk for Him? Our passage for today, thankfully, is going to show us why and how we can take those kinds of risks that God calls us to. And as we go there, again, we're in Joshua chapter 2. It's important that you understand the scene that we're jumping into. It's a super dramatic moment in the history of Israel. They've waited centuries for this promise to go into the promised land to be fulfilled. So I thought maybe a little music could help set the mood here. Here we go. Okay, it's the nation of Israel. They're at the edge of the Jordan River after waiting 40 years to get into the promised land. Moses has died, but Joshua is now in charge, ready to lead them into the promised land, the land flowing with milk and honey. Enough with the music? All right, no more music. All right. But how about a quick joke? You know the only person in the Bible without parents, right? Look with me in Joshua chapter 2, verse 1, as we start to read about Joshua, the son of Nun. Ba-dum-bum. All right. Here we go. Verses 1 through 3, Joshua chapter 2. And Joshua, the son of Nun, sent two men secretly from Shittim as spies, saying, "Go, view the land, especially Jericho." And they went and came into the house of a prostitute whose name was Rahab and lodged there. And it was told to the king of Jericho, "Behold, men of Israel have come here tonight to search out the land." Then the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, "Bring out the men who have come to you, who entered your house, for they have come to search out all the land." All right, let's begin with this first thought. Risking it all to have it all starts when you re-examine your allegiance. You're feeling the tension here, right? An entire nation is on the verge of entering the promised land, but an enemy is squatting in their land. And two spies have snuck undercover to get into the city, but their cover was blown. And the king knows about it, and so he has sent two of his men, probably hit men, to pay Rahab a little visit. So what is Rahab going to do when these two guys come knocking on her door? Actually, I don't think these are the kind of guys that knock on doors. They're the kind that burst through the door demanding that they give her what they're looking for. And so what is Rahab going to do? Is she going to fold or is she going to stand firm? Let's look in the text, starting in verse 4. But the woman, Rahab, had taken the two men and hidden them. And she said, "True, the men came to me, but I did not know where they came from. And when the gate was about to be closed at dark, the men went out. I do not know where the men went. Pursue them quickly, for you will overtake them." But she had brought them up to the roof and hid them with the stalks of flax that she had laid in order on the roof. So the men pursued after them on the way to the Jordan as far as the fords. And the gate was shut as soon as the pursuers had gone out. What just happened there? Rahab just told the king's men that the spies had left. Rahab stood up to her own countrymen to protect the spies. Right before our eyes, she's changing her allegiance from Canaan to Israel. You see, we need to understand that hiding the spies was an act of treason. If she gets caught, she's going to die. And so this idea of risking it all at great cost reminds me of back in the early 2000s when I was serving as a missionary. One of the most exciting works that we got to do was ministering to the many families that were fleeing the war in Bosnia and Serbia. And we became close and, of course, I was able to share the gospel. But here was the answer that I heard so many times. I would love to know Jesus like you do, but I just can't. And, of course, I would ask, well, but why? And they would say this. Because if I do, my family will disown me. And so how astonishing is it that Rahab pledged her allegiance now to Israel and to their God? Rahab risked everything. Her citizenship, her identity, her life. Now, can we have just a moment, Terry, sidebar here? Sidebar, okay, you there with me? All right. So, in the process of doing this very noble deed of honoring one of the absolutes of protecting life, what did Rahab do? She broke one of the other absolutes of lying. And so many, many people have written and studied about this. I read a lot about it this week. And here's what one Bible scholar said to help make sense of this conflict between these two absolutes. In evaluating Rahab, we must render a mixed verdict, one that condemns her lie. It was wrong for her to lie. But one that also commends her faith in word and deed. Another way to look at this is that the ethics of her decision to lie they're just simply not addressed in this passage. And because of our commitment to preaching through God's word, how God would want us to preach it, okay, we're going to move forward now and get back to how this text now applies to our lives. But please, if you're feeling like, I want to learn more, I promise you, there's lots out there, and I'd be happy to give you some direction on what to read if you want to learn more about this ethics issue. But back now to, again, how does this apply to us? And again, the scriptures are very clear. Rahab's faith moved her to make a radical commitment to God. Rahab's faith moved her to make a radical commitment to God, which I know means that you are asking, how can I have that kind of faith? How can I have that kind of commitment? And listen, I believe that there are so many things that could be said and they would all be right. But I sensed that the Holy Spirit was leading me to this point that I want to share with you right now, because in Romans 8, it says that faith comes from hearing the word of God. And so faith, if you want to have the kind of faith that Rahab demonstrated, it begins with this: drawing near to God by dwelling in his word and letting his word dwell in you. Let me say that again. For us to believe like Rahab did, to take the kinds of risk that she did, it means drawing near to God by dwelling in his word and letting his word dwell in you. When you allow your soul to be penetrated by the love and the majesty of God through his word, and you'll have a faith a lot like Rahab's, ready, willing to take great risks for God. All right, let's jump back in the text. We're going to pick up at verse 8. Here we go. Before the men lay down, she came up to them on the roof and said to the men, I know that the Lord has given you the land, and that the fear of you has fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land melt away before you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea before you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, to Sihon and Og, whom you devoted to destruction. And as soon as we heard it, our hearts melted, and there was no spirit left in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in the heavens above and on the earth below. Well, Rahab, she's just run up to the roof to talk to the men. And I'm feeling like the men are probably still wiping away the sweat from what could have just happened with the king's men. That was such a close call. But now they're stressing about, how are we going to get out of Jericho? So Rahab, though, she wants to talk about something more important. She wants to talk about God. You see, in Exodus chapter 9, verse 16, it says that God would make his name, his renown, known in all the earth. And Rahab is a living, breathing example of that promise fulfilled. And because of what she's learned about God, her heart is starting to melt. She's moving from knowing about God to knowing him personally. Right before our eyes in the text here, she's experiencing a pivotal shift in her beliefs from the pagan worship of Canaan to now wanting to love the Lord her God, the God of Israel. And here's the thing, that all started when she came to recognize God for who he is, a God of great power. It reminds me of when I was growing up. My favorite section of science class was when the teacher would bring out the microscopes. And with it, she would bring the tray of slides. Remember what I'm talking about? The slides that would have the little labels on them that would say fungus or bacteria or bugs, like cool stuff like that, right? But to the naked eye, like, what are you talking about? I don't see anything. But then we would put it under the microscope and boom, it would be magnified and we could see whatever that was as it really is. And I want to suggest today that the Word of God is like a microscope, shining brightly for us, enlarging for us who this great God is, illuminating for our hearts his character, his majesty. Through the scriptures, we can recognize God for who he really is. And when we recognize God for who he really is, then he's magnified. And when God is magnified, faith comes. And when faith comes, fear goes. Well, I wonder if there is someone here today who senses that God is calling you to turn to Jesus, to embrace him as your Savior, but you're hesitating. You're reluctant. Because you think that you have to figure some things out. You got to straighten up a little bit before you can come to Jesus. But 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone. Behold, he makes all things new. Listen, I'll give it to you. I get that it's a risk to trust Christ with your life. But it's a tragic risk for you to go one more day without him. Because God has the power to make crooked paths straight. And there's someone today who knows that a decision needs to be made to put to death that destructive habit that is starving your soul. But you can't imagine living without it. Psalm 34:10 says, the young lions will suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. It's a risk to trust that God could satisfy all of your longings. But it will be a disastrous risk if you live like the world could really fulfill you. God has the power to give you new desires. As a church, God has called us to tell the world about Jesus, to share the gospel with our neighbors and our friends and our family. But you're afraid. You're afraid you might not say it right, or that they might do something to you. But Romans 1:16 says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for the salvation of all who believe. I get it. It is a risk. I've been there. Opening your mouth to share the gospel is risky business. But what an awful risk it would be to deny yourself the opportunity to be used by God to lead someone to salvation. God gives his children the power through the Holy Spirit to speak as we ought to speak about Jesus. All right, let's go back to the text. We're going to pick up in verse 12. Here we go, verse 12. Now then, please swear to me by the Lord that as I have dealt kindly with you, you also will deal kindly with my father's house and give me a sure sign that you will save alive my father and mother and brothers and sisters and all who belong to them and deliver our lives from death. And the men said to her, our life for yours, even to death. If you do not tell this business of ours, then when the Lord gives us the land, we will deal kindly and faithfully with you. Now Rahab is showing that to risk it all, you need to remove the barriers. Remove the barriers. And what I love about Rahab's appeal is that she negotiates politely, but firmly. Something that might be unexpected in this very patriarchal culture in Canaan. She's going to the men, to the spies, to plead with them to save her father and mother and brothers and sisters and all of their household too while we're at it. She moves past any possible barriers related to her occupation or the impression that she might be acting a little pushy, pleading that her family would be rescued. She risks it all to transfer herself and her family out of the lifeless paganism of Canaan and into the life-giving protection of Israel and the one true God. I tell you what, as I have gotten to witness Rahab's excellent faith, she really makes me think a lot about the women of this church. And so, ladies, I want to speak to you for a moment. Men, you should listen in because you need to hear this. Okay. I am so thankful to God for how the women of this church, day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, continue to take the risk, driven by faith, to push through barriers, to be able to be a blessing to their homes and to their community. And yes, to this church. And so I'm just moved today to say thank you to the women of this church. Now, the heart behind Rahab's appeal is clearly love. So let's be a family that is known for being people like that too. And a long time ago, I learned a lesson about how to love others well. And it's so simple. It's two words. Show up. Show up. And in 2019, there are so many ways that we can show up. We can send a text. We can write an encouraging post. We can leave a voicemail with a prayer. We can take someone out for a coffee. We can sign up people on a website to receive meals when they have babies or when they're in the hospital. There's so many things we can do. The key is this: show up. Show up. And when we do, we will be loving well. Rahab's pretty impressive so far, isn't she? But this next thought, I think, is what really sets her apart. If you're going to step out in faith and take a risk for God, then you need to respond with obedience. We'll pick up in verse 18. Behold, when we come into the land, you shall tie this scarlet cord in the window through which you let us down. And you shall gather into your house your father and mother, your brothers, and all your father's household. Then, if anyone goes out of the doors of your house into the street, his blood shall be on his own head, and we shall be guiltless. But if a hand is laid on anyone who is with you in the house, his blood shall be on our head. But if you tell this business of ours, then we shall be guiltless with respect to your oath that you have made us swear. So Rahab has gotten the promise that she was looking for. Her family's going to be taken care of. And now the spies have given her specific instructions in order to make sure that they follow through on their commitment. She's to gather all of her loved ones into her house, and she is to tie a red cord, a scarlet cord, on her window. By the way, don't you just love the unity in God's word? That reminds us of another story a few books earlier, right? The Passover, the blood on the door. I love the unity in the scriptures when it comes to the story of God delivering his people. It's so cool. So it was interesting that she had this scarlet cord, but will she use it? Let's go back to the text and find out. Verse 21. And she said, according to your words, so be it. Then she sent them away, and they departed. And here it is. And she tied the scarlet cord in the window. Rahab didn't waste any time. Immediate obedience. Her mother would have been proud, probably, right? She didn't let the tension of the moment deter her. She didn't let the fear of, well, what will people think that I have a red cord hanging from my window keep her from doing what she was told to do. No, she responds with tenacious, immediate obedience. Well done, Rahab. And I wish I could say that I was like that too. And I think if we were all honest, we have some room to grow in having that kind of radical obedience. Reminds me of my final year of playing soccer in college, my senior year. I suffered this awful wound, bruise in my thigh, and the trainer tried everything, and nothing was working. And right before my eyes, my last season is slipping away. I was so frustrated. And so the trainer came to me finally, and he said, listen, don't tell anybody that I told you to do this, which should have been my first clue that this may be trouble, but I was willing to do whatever. And so he said, listen, on the way home, stop at the gas station and pick up a tin of chewing tobacco. You can't write this stuff. I'm not making this up. This really happened, okay? So pick this up, and then while you're studying tonight, take just a little bit, put it on your thigh, wrap it with the ACE bandage, and let it sit for 20 minutes or so, and then take it off, clean up, and then do it again a little later. Try that 3 or 4 times, and we'll see what happens. So being the bright college kid that I was, I decided that I knew better, and so I waited until the very end of the night, at which point I took the entire can of chewing tobacco, put it on my thigh, wrapped it with the ACE bandage, and went to bed for 8 hours. Yeah. So truth be told, I did wake up and my leg felt a lot better, but the rest of me felt awful. And it took a long time for my body to flush out an entire can full of nicotine, if you know what I mean. So technically, did I do what the trainer told me to do? Yeah. But I hadn't followed his instructions, and believe me, I paid the price. And how often we do the same thing. God tells us to do something, but we only do part of it. You said that you forgave that person for for that rude comment, but you continue to hang on to it, letting it be a wedge in your relationship. You dutifully go to work every day, but truth be told, you spend a lot of your time surfing the web. You say you believe that God is your provider, but your credit card bill would say something different. You've put blocks in all of those devices that your wife thinks you have, but you've kept one that still gives you access to darkness. You say that you believe that gossip is wrong, but you keep trying to find ways to justify the things that you say. Listen, I have learned the hard way. Partial obedience is disobedience. To not obey God's word is to not honor Jesus Christ as Lord. But it doesn't have to be that way. We can be a church where we show our love for God by the way we obey his commands. And so here are three simple steps that you can take starting today to grow stronger in your obedience. Number one, pray. Pray. Ask God to give you the desire and the discipline to be obedient, as well as disgust for your disobedience. Second, pinpoint. Get with God and look at a passage like Galatians 5, 16 through 21, or Colossians 3, 5 through 8. I'll give those to you again. Galatians 5, 16 through 21, or Colossians 3, 5 through 8, and identify one or two of those sins that God would say, my son, my daughter, I want to work on that one. But if you're going to work on it, here's the third key to growing in obedience. You need a partner. God never intended for you to get victory in this area on your own. You need a buddy. And you need to put a buddy system into effect today. Find another person that you can do this together with, where you can mutually minister to each other by praying for each other and encouraging each other and holding one another to the commitments that you are going to make. So Rahab risked it all with radical obedience. And because she did, this leads to our last thought. She reaped the rewards. Let's look finally at verse 22. They departed and went into the hills and remained there 3 days until the pursuers returned. And the pursuers searched all along the way and found nothing. Then the two men returned. They came down from the hills and passed over and came to Joshua, the son of Nun. And they told him all that had happened. And they said to Joshua, truly, the Lord has given all the land into our hands. And also all the inhabitants of the land melt away because of us. Really, this is going to be a forecast to the coming victory. If you look at Joshua 6 later today, you'll see, no surprise, God wins again, right? But what we can take from this forecast here in these final verses is that blessing followed Rahab's obedience. Blessing follows obedience. Sometimes our obedience blesses those we don't even know. Like Rahab's obedience blessed an entire nation. Other times our obedience blesses those closest to us, like Rahab's obedience blessed her family. And then sometimes, because God's just so good, he blesses our obedience personally. And God did that for Rahab in three ways, and I want to walk through each one right now. First, Rahab went from being a social outcast in Canaan to marrying an Israelite named Solomon. Not Solomon, but Solomon. But it doesn't stop there. God was just getting started. Together, Rahab and Solomon gave birth to Boaz, who married Ruth, who gave birth to Obed, who fathered Jesse, who fathered David. Do you see where we're going here? Little did Rahab know that God was going to use her in the family line of who? Jesus Christ. to demonstrate to the world that he is a God for all people, all nations, all tribes, all tongues, all classes. That's who our God is. And he works through ordinary people with uncommon faith to do extraordinary things like this. But none of that happens unless Rahab steps out in faith and takes the risk that she did. And you know what those risks were? They were the works that were the evidence of her faith in the Lord. That's why James chapter 2, 25 through 26 says, "And in the same way, was not also Rahab the prostitute justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead." Rahab's risk to protect the spies, to hang the scarlet cord from her window, were works that were the evidence of her faith. And because through faith she risked it all, God would then inspire the Holy Spirit, would inspire the author of Hebrews centuries later to then write Rahab into the hall of faith. I just love the Lord and how he works. Well, this week, as you heard Pastor Tommy share, a number of our high schoolers went up to Camp Harvest and they had an amazing week. My two high schoolers went up and for sure they did. And I have no doubt we'll see some heart-pumping video about the camp here in a week or so. But I heard this one story that I just couldn't wait to share with you. In the weeks leading up to the camp, the student ministry team found that there was a student who had signed up to come to camp again. And this was a student who, just simply put, was a difficult camper in the years past. But instead of getting anxious that this student was coming to camp, you know our pastors, right? Tommy, Noah, Brandon, they didn't get anxious about this. They said, "No, we're going to lean into this." They seized the opportunity. They stepped up and took the risk and began to pray by faith that this would be the camp when this student would have a heart melted by God's power, that he would encounter the life-changing, sin-forgiving Jesus. Their love, those pastors' love for this student and their hard work in prayer became further evidence of their own faith in Jesus, but it gets even better. Because of their risk to pray the way that they did, I'm so happy to be able to tell you that this student came to know Jesus this week. So remember, today hasn't been about pumping you up to start riding crazy roller coasters or taking other wild risks like that. Through Rahab's example, God's word is showing us that ordinary people with uncommon faith can take risks to be part of the good works that God has prepared for us to do. How do we do that? We look to the God who is faithful and reliable as we re-examine our allegiance and recognize his power and remove the barriers and respond with obedience, anticipating the day that we'll reap the rewards for God's glory. And those kinds of movements that I know you want to be a part of are rooted, they're started in prayer. And so as we finish up this time right now, I'm going to invite you to close your eyes and bow your head, and we're going to pray. And if you're comfortable, go ahead and just even open your hands as a sign to the Lord that you're willing. Here I am, Lord. Hands open as a symbol to you that I'm willing. And as we go into this moment of prayer, I want to ask you a question. For who are you willing to risk? Here's another one. What is it that God would be calling you to take a risk to do? Do you have that person in mind? Do you have that situation right there? Because we're going to pray right now. God, here we are. Send us, God. We're willing. We want to be used by you, Lord. And so fill us with the Holy Spirit so that we would have all of the power through your presence in our lives to be the sent ones that you called us to be, to go and hold forth the word of God, to share boldly as we ought to speak, to stand up for truth, to fight for justice, whatever the situation is, God. I pray for every person in our church today that you would give us every bit of your presence in our lives, your power, your peace. Give us everything, God. We need it all because apart from you, we can do nothing. But with you, God, there's no limit to what you could do. Jesus, you even said that through your Holy Spirit, we could do more than you even did, which I can't even understand that. But God, you said so, and we're claiming that promise today in Jesus' name that you would work through every person today and then again tomorrow through your work in our lives to be who you called us to be, disciples of Jesus Christ, shining bright in this world, making much of Jesus Christ in the different areas of our lives that you are calling us to take risks to do. We love you, God. We trust you, and we pray this all in your name. Amen.